Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
All right.
Hi, everybody. We bought candy.
Hi.
All right. We're sticking in for Halloween. Yeah. So, happy Halloween.
It's already been my costume. All right.
So, just to tell a little bit about you. So, first, I know you know me. I don't think you know me, so I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Adina Solomon, and I'm part of SPGA Georgia. I co-founded the chapter back in 2013. And I'm now a freelance writer, and my day job is I'm a content strategist for UPS. So what are the best practices for covering the LGBT community and issues? This one-hour session will provide 10 tips for reporting on the LGBT issues. You'll also meet Jessica Fisher, who will share her experience with the AJC, Atlanta Journal-Constitution, on the transgender community article that was written. And I would like to introduce you to Dyana Bagby, staff writer for Springs Publishing, which includes Reporter, Newspapers, and Atlanta INtown. Dyana is the former editor of the Georgia Voice, the state's leading LGBT newspaper, and also has served as deputy editor of Southern Voice, an LGBT newspaper that's served the community for more than 40 years. So please welcome them to Media Atlanta.
And actually, the Southern Voice was only around about 20 years.
Also, oh, I'm sorry.
A mistake. I probably.
My apologies.
No, but I guess I'll go. Let me go first with just some basic. So I had a PowerPoint presentation, but I don't know if we can. I called it the Gay Agenda: Words Matter, Fabulous Tips on Reporting on LGBT Issues and Topics. So the AP, Associated Press, actually has some pretty good style guide, basic tips. So I'll just start out first by giving you guys candy.
Happy Halloween. You each get your own bag.
Well,
you guys, I didn't know how many people would be here. And we can have some to share.
Thanks for attending. So some of the basic tips, LGBT. The letters LGBT are acceptable when you're reporting, but oftentimes it's still necessary on first reference to write lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender out. And I do that at the newspaper that I work at now. When I worked at the gay media, we didn't have to write that. But in the mainstream media, it's probably still. LGBTQ, with the Q at the end, is also acceptable nowadays. And the Q can stand for questioning, queer, or both. So that has made it into pretty much the mainstream lexicon as well. Lesbian is the preferred term for women who are attracted to other women. Gay is preferred over homosexual for men who are attracted to other men. Homosexual is just like a negative connotation to it, so don't use it. Bisexual, no hyphen. And that is a person who is attracted to more than one gender. Transgender is an adjective to describe a person who identifies themselves as having a gender different from the one they were assigned to at birth. A transgender woman was assigned as male at birth, for example. A transgender man was assigned female at birth. Do not say a person is a transgender. Don't say that, don't use it as a noun. If that makes sense, yeah. Always, this should be pretty practical. I mean, always refer to a transgender person by the gender pronoun they ask you to. If that pronoun is not expressed, you should use the pronoun consistent with the way the person lives publicly, according to the AP.
Do you mind if I speak to
yes,
that real quick?
Yes, please, go ahead.
So that is what the AP Style Guide currently says. Unfortunately, that kind of flies in the face of what transgender activists encourage people to do on a day-to-day basis, which is if you don't know someone's pronouns, if they don't tell you outright, just ask. It's always easier to just ask and get it right for everyone involved than to try and assume one way or the other.
Absolutely. Always. That's should be big, yeah. So if the person prefers the gender neutral pronoun they, AP recommends a story note, that the story notes the individual pronoun preference, and then refer to the person by their last name and future references in the story.
So just one quick question.
Yeah.
You would do that toward the beginning before you start using the pronoun?
Correct. You would say, so-and-so prefers to use the pronoun they, and then throughout the story, would say, and they said this. Although the AP recommends that you use their last name throughout the story, which can be easier to follow if you're reading, which I have done. And even in the gay media, LGBT media, I would do that as well, just because it reads easier right now. I mean, it is changing. I imagine it will be 5 years from now, it will be completely acceptable and understood when you read a story that they is their pronoun. But right now, I would say the language, particularly around transgender issues and gender neutral issues and gender non-conforming issues, is evolving pretty rapidly, and it's still trying to be figured out. I don't know if you would disagree with that or agree with it.
What I would say on that is this is an area where I feel like it's unfortunate that journalism is letting grammar take the lead, only because grammaticians, if that's the right word, don't take the lead on anything. They're like the last people to change. I definitely think that there's plenty of times when we use the singular they in regular conversation. And so I definitely think that the reader would understand.
And that, I mean, journalists are responsible for shaping the language that we use, and that is an important note that we probably, I know I can be slow to change as well, but anyway. So, I'm a member of the NLGJA, and they also have some tips. This is the National, used to be the National Lesbian and Gay Journalists Association, but now it's changed its name. It's just the National Journalists Association, but it still kept its NLGJA. So if a source shares transgender or gender nonconforming identity, it is best practice to ask for preferred pronouns. Just ask. Be cautious that a person's pronoun may not correspond with the gender that they may be associated with one's name or appearance. So, also do not assume transgender status or include it if it is not germane to the story. So, I think we're going to talk a lot more about transgender reporting in a few minutes, so I will just touch on these. On transgender reporting, transgender people identify as a gender that is different from the sex they were assigned at birth. So that's important to note. So on the issue of balance, when covering controversial or sensitive issues, it's standard journalism practice to seek out opposing views to provide balance to a story. However, there are times when balance doesn't further understanding of the issues or the story. And a lot of that, I'll just touch, is that, like in the marriage equality debate, so this is an example, I'll just give an example of when I started reporting, it was known as gay marriage, and it evolved over time to marriage equality. The activists working on marriage equality were calling it for marriage equality for many years before the journalists, even the LGBT media started calling it marriage equality. So that's just one example of how the language has changed over the years. It was slow to change. In fact, the activists who are on the ground have the best language for their issues, if you want to know the truth. But to always have to go and talk to an anti-gay source to try and be fair is just really, I don't think, journalistic responsibility. It's not always being journalistically responsible. You don't need to go and speak to, who are some of the big anti-gay activists that are LGBT activists that we have out there? You know.
What's his name? Stein. Yeah, I'm aware.
You know. It's not always. You're not going to get something fair from them if you're trying to be fair in your story. Talking to.
A good analogy might be that if you're covering a civil rights issue or a police brutality issue, you don't have to find the local head of the Klan to interview.
Exactly.
Them.
Thank you. Thank you. And a lot of people did, a lot of response, you know, mainstream newspapers and stories were doing that. And it just would kill me that they were giving so much airtime to these idiots. So I have 9 tips to do justice to transgender reporting. And if you disagree with any of these, please let me know. Stop writing the same story. And the same story is when the media started covering gay people, you know, their stories were all about coming out. Like all these people who are coming out. And so transgender stories are now in that phase a lot where it's just about someone's coming out story. There's a lot more to transgender people than their coming out story. There's jobs, housing, education, you know, stuff like that. Pursue the ordinary. I mean, like a transgender person looking for a job in this economy, you know, is an ordinary story with a little different angle. I know this is popular, but if you want to start setting a trend, stop asking for before and after photos. I don't know if you are offended by someone asking for before and after photos.
Right. Well, and the reason that's important is because it kind of goes back to number one on your list there.
Right.
It focuses the transition itself,
mm-hmm.
Which, you know, isn't newsworthy. Medical stories on, like, almost anyone is hardly ever newsworthy. You know, if the president has to go to the doctor for something, maybe that's newsworthy. But other than that, it's just not pertinent.
Yeah.
You know, that one stunts me because I can't imagine asking anybody
that
if I were
say that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, as interviewing somebody, oh, could you show me some, that's mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Well, I just was reading a story in the AJC, which, I don't know if you read it, the child that came out or is transitioning, it was just in the other day. The mother wrote the story. And throughout the story, so it's her daughter is transitioning to a male, and throughout the story used female pronouns, and had a picture of the little girl when she was a little girl. Her name is Emma. And did you not read that story?
My subscription to the AJC has lapsed recently. Coincidentally, it was running out around the same time that the story that I was interviewed for finally was published. But no, so I haven't read that story.
Yeah, so I didn't understand it. But stop asking about someone's medical transition process. Just stop it. That's, I mean, easy. Stop using outdated or dehumanizing language. And if you're unsure about which pronoun to use, ask the person you're writing about. And remember, transgender women are women, transgender men are men, and everyone is human. And if you make a mistake, learn from it. You know. But I think that is like, everyone is human, is like basic. So these are just some other things that I have a personal. Do not use the term sexual preference, please. Please stop using that. I still read it these days. The preferred term is sexual orientation, or the correct term. The reason is because the term sexual preference suggests that being lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender is a free choice. In some cases, this may be true. But the term has been adopted by anti-LGBT individuals and organizations seeking to cure LGBT people of their preference. And we don't want to be cured. And to call it the gay lifestyle and the homosexual lifestyle, you know, don't use that either, because they're often used as pejoratives. The lifestyles of LGBT people are as diverse as those of other folk. So, remember that. And, let me see. About that gay agenda. There really is no gay agenda. So no need to use that phrase, or LGBT agenda. Because these terms are used by some to create the perception of a coordinated, negative, and sinister conspiracy rather than the pursuit of equality. So those are just some of the tips, you know, basic little tips that I have. And Jessica, please.
Absolutely.
Take over.
So my name is Jessica Fisher. My pronouns are she, her. I'm a senior at Kennesaw State University and majoring in communications and journalism. That was really good. That had a lot of really good information that I was also going to cover. So now I'm trying to figure out where I want to start. I guess to pick up the first place I'll start is to talk about, of course, it's really popular right now to talk about bathroom bills.
Mm-hmm.
The GLAD Media Guide, and I always forget what the acronym stands for, but it's GLAAD.
Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation.
And their media guide is superb. I think it's 66 pages. And it's a wonderful supplement to the AP Style Guide if you're looking to cover LGBT topics. But so their entry on the bathroom bill, they say it's a term created and used by far-right extremists to oppose non-discrimination laws that protect transgender people. So simply refer to the non-discrimination law or ordinance instead of calling it a bathroom bill. And there's obviously, I could talk an entire hour on the politics of bathroom bills and protecting our children and our wives.
Are you guys familiar with bathroom bill? With the bathroom?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely.
North
Absolutely.
Carolina and
right.
Yeah.
HB2, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
and Georgia for that matter, but...
Is Georgia, because I know the case is going to the Supreme Court, is Georgia part of the lawsuit challenging or...?
Right, so the Obama administration handed down some guidelines around Title IX, and Attorney General, maybe now former Attorney General Sam Olens, mm-hmm. Added Georgia to that list of, I think, 9 or 11 states, minority of states, suing the federal government about those guidelines on allowing transgender youth to use bathrooms and other facilities in public schools that, you know, coincide with their gender. That's ongoing. That's a fun time. A couple other things I want to reemphasize too is never say that a transgender person is born male or born female. We always want to say that a transgender person is assigned male at birth or assigned female at birth, because you're not born a man or a woman. You're born a baby, basically. We went over pronouns. You know, I spoke on this topic just last week at KSU, and after I got done presenting and we went down there, we had like a little meet and greet afterwards and we had pizza, and I was talking to one of the people who had attended the event, and we were kind of having a three-way conversation, and one of the people, they were referring to me and they're like, oh, well, he said, and I was like, we just went over this not 10 minutes ago. So I don't know. I understand that can be difficult, but it's just intentionality. And you know, in a story, especially if you're gonna go to print, you never have time to get it wrong. So if you're subscribed to the AJC, you read, it was July 4th weekend cover story. I was interviewed for this story. And it wasn't ideally written. But the bigger problem, other than the way that it was written, was the interviewer and I were not on the same page. The interviewer was asking me questions that I didn't feel were pertinent to what I thought we were talking about. I thought that we would be talking about Stonewall Housing, which is a nest community at KSU for LGBT students. I thought we would be talking about the decision for Attorney General Sam Olens to add Georgia to that lawsuit against the federal government, and I thought we would be talking about these sorts of issues. I ended up getting a lot of questions like, well, what was it like for you in middle school, and what was it like for you in high school, and what do your parents think, and can I interview your parents, and just a lot of things that weren't pertinent, and then these were the things that were centered in the story when the story got published. So it was about how I struggled in high school and middle school and how I was bullied and things like that, when I thought I was being talked to as like not only a transgender person but as an activist and a student and a writer myself who has, you know, very strong opinions about these things. But that had not been the case. And then the story went on to say that I was born male, and then it said that I tried to keep my head down and just assimilate, which I'm like, no, I'm known as a troublemaker, so that's not accurate. And I think if I wasn't known as a troublemaker, that interviewer and I would never have been connected. They probably would have been connected with somebody else. That's kind of what brought me here today, is that I went through that experience, and it was a difficult experience, and I was not pleased with the way that I was, you know, represented in that story, nor was I pleased with the way that I was interviewed. The interviewer, after asking, you know, after I'm like, you know, my name is Jessica, these are my pronouns, as they're leaving, they say to me, well, I hope you have a good day, sir. And I'm like, You know, it's just, it's these little things that can really ruin, you know, a rapport between an interviewer and an interviewee, and if you want to have sources such as myself, you just want to, you know, take the extra time, do the little bit of extra research, and, you know, try and get it right. So yeah, that's kind of the quick rundown of my notes. Do you have any questions?
Well, I was just going to say that interviewing you on the housing at KSU is a perfect example of Pursue the Ordinary.
Right.
You know, just talking to a transgender student about the story and not talking about their whole transition and what they went through in middle school and high school and what did your parents think and stuff like that, not focusing on the transition, but this person as a person who lives in LGBT housing or whatever.
Right, which is one of two universities in the state that has that sort of housing, so it's an ordinary story, but it's also but it's also highly unique,
right.
And it offers you something that's worth reading, worth writing,
right.
Because only two schools in the state do this.
I've got a few questions. You're saying the term homosexual is considered offensive. Is queer considered offensive? I mean, I really don't know. Because it's part of the acronym.
It is becoming less offensive, but the way we handled it in the gay media at my newspaper, I've seen it used, and when I say gay media, I'm apologizing for being so short, the LGBT media, is that we used it only if a person used that as their own self-identification. Some people do not like that word still and do not want it used. It has a history. I know guys that I worked with, mostly guys, were called that when they were children and made fun of it, that word.
Yeah, that's the thing. I thought that is an insulting kind of term.
So they don't like that. And for the longest time, we would not use LGBTQ either. I don't know if the Georgia Voice has changed that or not in recent months or whatever, but it just depends on the outlet, truthfully.
Okay.
I do see some other LGBT media outlets using the word queer as in the headlines and part of their identification as a queer media outlet and stuff
right.
like that.
So
just ask. I would ask the person.
Okay. Another question. I've sometimes seen it. It's like LGBTQ, and I've seen like other letters beyond that. I don't remember which letters they are. I'm sorry. But thoughts on that?
Usually
longer,
it's the I and A.
Is that right?
Two A's?
The I, sometimes two A's. You know, P for pansexual. You know, especially if you're doing print, if you're doing not website, and you're, you know, you have spatial limits. You know, you can just use LGBTQ. It's an issue within the community right now. You know, how long do we let this acronym go on before we try and find another way to represent everybody?
Okay. But for now, most of the time, LGBTQ would be the, okay. And I've got a third question. This is my last one. Talking about, you know, with pronouns, you just ask the person. I guess if I'm talking to someone, and it's not a story that's about strictly a transgender issue or something like that, but let's say I'm not sure, I don't want to, I guess, offend somebody. You know, do I say, you know, he or she for you? I mean, I could see that being really offensive to somebody. So I guess ways to ask, or should it just go ahead and ask? I mean, what do you guys think about that?
I would just ask, say, which pronoun do you prefer?
Just throw it out.
Yeah,
right, yeah. If you're interviewing a trans person, I can't imagine them getting upset. If you're interviewing a cisgender person and they do get upset, I mean, that might happen, but you can also just explain to them that this is, you know, procedure.
Okay.
Just the same as getting the correct spelling of their name, just as, like, you know, getting a way to contact them. It's all just procedure at the interview.
Okay. I like that. Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
And cisgender... Does everyone know what cisgender is?
Yeah.
I don't, I'm sorry.
I never can remember what the CIS stands for, but I know what cisgender is, what is the CIS? I know what it means. It means a person who accepts their assigned, you know, their birth assigned gender, but.
I don't know what the CIS stands for.
So it's actually, it's Latin. If you take chemistry, you know cis and trans in a different context.
Yes,
because they use these in chemistry. But so cis is a Latin prefix meaning on the same side as.
Mm-hmm.
So cisgender is a term used by some to describe people who are not transgender. You know, and this is a way to avoid, you know, saying non-transgender. You know, and so it helps to, like, not otherize anybody. It's just, you know, some people are cisgender and some people are transgender.
Yeah, I spent a lot of time on Twitter, so where there's a pretty substantial transgender community, so I see the word a lot.
Well, that word also, and just part of this evolving language, that word's just popped up in the past 3 years, maybe?
I think in like, the popular eye, definitely, it's... I'm not sure how far back it dates in academia or activism.
But in the mainstream media, especially,
right.
It's just been recently. Because I can remember writing biological female, biological male.
Mm-hmm.
That was the former term.
Right.
I started seeing that. I can tell you what year I started seeing it a lot. It was 2014. I've
mm-hmm.
got other associations discussions on Twitter. And so that was when I started seeing it and had to look it up.
You're one of the smart ones looking it up.
Right.
Yeah.
Good for you. Thanks.
Let me see if there's anything else. This gives good guidance. It's a good list.
Mm-hmm.
I have some questions.
Sure.
So this reporter called you and said, hey, I want to talk to you about housing.
I was put in contact through, we were put in contact through, the reporter got in contact with PR at Kennesaw State,
mm-hmm.
and PR got in contact with Jessica Duvall with GLBTIQ student programs, and then Jessica Duvall got in contact with me and put me in contact with this reporter.
And how long ago did the interview take place?
We had two phone interviews and one in-person interview.
Wow.
Right. And I want to say that, so the first one was probably May or June.
And the story was supposed to be just on the housing program.
Right, well, yeah, it was supposed to be, that's kind of the nebulous thing about it, is that it itself was nebulous. It was supposed to be on the housing program, but also on, the Title IX issues, and because KSU is a public university, Title IX obviously affects KSU, and so it was kind of all tied together, and that was what it was supposed to be about at that point.
Okay.
I don't like trashing other reporters a lot, but that sounds incompetent, because if I contact somebody on the basis of one kind of story, and all of a sudden I'm writing about their life history, that's...
Well,
yeah, that's strange to me as well. Yeah, why would you tell this person's life story like that in detail? You wouldn't do that for any other context. You wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes you go into a story and you find a different story, you know.
But I usually tell the person that it's a different story at that. You know, it's even in the SBJ Code of Ethics, you don't misrepresent what you're going to be writing about.
Right, yeah, exactly.
You know.
Right, and so there were two or three interviews. And that's, I guess, to contextualize, by the time this got to print, it was the one journalist I spoke to and another journalist shared a byline, and there were, I don't know, 3 to 5 transgender individuals interviewed and written about. And even though we had these 3 30-minute interviews, my entire section of the story came out to be like 158 words.
Yeah, that happens.
Right, right. When it gets cut down that much, it's easier to misrepresent. And I definitely felt misrepresented.
What's interesting too is they kind of went through your life story, but it sounds like they were telling a story that you didn't even really tell them. You kind of told them one thing about yourself, and it sounds like they kind of put this into like a kind of a stereotypical story.
Right, it became
being a quiet kid and that kind of stuff, or whatever
right,
I was.
Right, it became five interviews about how hard it is to be transgender in Georgia, and oh and woe are these poor, you know, transgender kids who, you know, can't catch a break. And what I was trying to do was have an interview and have a conversation about, no, we are actually, you know, myself personally standing up and, you know, I won't accept this. And, you know, I called Sam Owens' office when Georgia joined that lawsuit, and I was like, you know, because I am a voting taxpaying citizen, and, you know, so it, yeah, definitely started as one thing and became something completely different.
Yeah, that thing is interesting, the way it kind of squeezed you into this narrative, what it sounds like.
Exactly.
To me, anyway.
And
yeah.
that's what we have to try and teach reporters not to do, is to not come in with the idea, oh, trans kids, poor trans kids, you know, poor trans people.
Mm-hmm.
When they're obviously doing great things, you know, and changing the world for the better. So
right.
Yeah, I'm just sorry that you went through that.
Yeah, and I mean, it's, you know, you can chalk it up to growing pains, I think.
Yeah.
And, well, this is the other thing I wanted, I guess, to speak about that I almost forgot to, is it's kind of a structural thing. This isn't, you know, something the AP style guide harps on. This isn't something they are leading on. You know, being in college now, working, I have an AA in communications. I'm getting my BS in communications. You know, it's not at a structural level. How to cover transgender people isn't taught. We talk about how to cover differently abled people. We talk about how to cover people of different races and religions and ethnicities. We talk about how to cover men and women. We talk about how to cover LGB people. But we don't talk about how to cover trans people. So it's a structural thing that no one is getting the education. So then they do have to go out and they have to come to these panels, or they have to Google the GLAAD Media Guide, and sometimes, even though that seems like due diligence, it still falls through the cracks.
I mean, one thing is the awareness of transgender issues is just, with the general public, you know,
right.
is just now, you know, there's like a lag, and my wife's a social worker, and it's become a big seminar thing now because of the fact that that it's not something that was generally covered in social work school.
Right.
And the only reason, as I said, Twitter is the only recent accidents of who I was interacting with on Twitter is the only reason that I was even aware of the term transgender,
right.
You know, as of 2014.
Right.
So, yeah.
Well, I mean, it's obviously the civil rights push movement. I mean, it's the next movement in the LGBT movement. I mean,
yeah. And I think HB2 is probably a lot of people's first, you know, the general public. The press should know, you know, should be kind of out in front of you know, things as they happen. But
well, Supreme Court is taking on a case with the trans student in Virginia.
Right.
So, I mean, the media will have to absolutely, I hate using the media, but need to.
You can say we.
We absolutely, thank you. We absolutely need to stay on top of this. And I think making a very important point about us not being educated, even folks in the LGBT media, you know, are having to learn on the run and on the spot. And the best way really is to talk to people, you know, to talk to the activists on the ground, I think, who are leading the movement.
Did you have a question?
I was wondering if there's anything that you've liked about the article or any positive feedback that you got as a result of the article in July?
That's a good question. It was frustrating for me, and it still is. I would love to speak to the other people who were interviewed and know what they know what they think about it, know how they feel about it, and maybe something positive can come from that, because maybe that was a very positive experience for them. Again, for me, the most positive thing that came from it for me was that I had a freelance opportunity. I wrote about my experience, and then I wrote about how to cover transgender people, and I got that published. I'll admit, I'm the type of person, I want to believe in the benefit of the doubt. I want to believe that the journalist who wrote that story and everyone at the AJC meant the best. But sometimes you have to call things what they are, you know, even when it's upsetting. And for me personally, I just feel like, yeah, I feel like they messed up. And so, building back, we're talking about HB2, we're talking about the Supreme Court. I read a story on BuzzFeed, actually, long story, about the Gill Foundation, and if you don't know what the Gill Foundation is, check that out, and LGBT leaders, and how they are debating now, you know, next steps. And they're really looking at, you know, housing protections and employment protections, obviously very important things. The question, of course, will be if that's for LGB, you know, folks, or if that's for LGBT folks. We have history of things like the Employment Non-Discrimination Act in, like, Congress to try and get the pass. Folks like Barney Frank will take out gender identity and gender expression. Of course, it has still up to this day failed, but they will pull those types of ploys. But so the debate amongst LGBT leaders now is, you know, where do they, you know, put this whole, you know, bathroom bill thing? And they're saying it could be another 5 years until that gets addressed, which from my activist standpoint, you know, if it's another 5 years until that gets addressed, how much longer is it till conversion therapy becomes illegal? How much longer is it until, you know, we address transgender mental health, until we address transgender suicide, until we address, you know, transgender homelessness, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Amongst the LGBT community, black trans women are murdered more than anyone else. Their life expectancy is like 27, and for white trans women it's 35. So yeah, it's just like, if we have to wait another 5 years for the right to pee, how much longer do we have to wait for the right to live?
Did you say 27 years old is the life expectancy of a black trans woman? Is that what you just said?
That's correct. And I don't have the sources for those numbers with me, but if you look at things like the Williams Institute, they put out numbers. I think Transgender Equality puts out numbers, and there's another report that put out numbers. I think the last time they put out numbers was in 2012 or 2013. Yeah. And that's the other thing is, you know, the Census Bureau doesn't do this. The government at any level doesn't do this. Organizations themselves have to collect this information, and we just have to, you know, trust it.
Don't say born male or born female. What is it you're supposed to say instead of born male or born female?
Assigned male at birth, assigned female at birth.
Okay. That's
right. Yeah, and I could spend the rest of the day talking about the reasons behind that. But succinctly, it's just the idea that we don't have, gender isn't inherent. It's not biological, it's not anatomical, it's not chemical. It's social.
Yeah.
So we learn it. We're not born with it.
Yeah, I've got a 4-month old daughter right now, and we're taking her out. We always want to put a bow on her head, because if not, people will say, oh, you have such a beautiful son, it's a really pretty boy you have. So we put the bow on her head to let them know it's a girl. But like you're saying, there's no But Debbie doesn't know any of that, you know. So, I don't know. I thought it was interesting. That was a good story on NPR. You guys hear this? Maybe, I bet it was in the spring, maybe in April. It was about the bathroom stuff. And it was a transgender male, and they're, you know, by the law, would have to use the women's bathroom, but you know, it looks outwardly like a man, and they're saying that there's a long interview, and it was talking about. It was just really interesting. I don't know. Did you guys hear any of this? Hear that report?
I've heard stories like that. I did hear that NPR report. And actually, you know, I would love to go back and do a study about how the media covered when you know, people were going to Target and they were standing outside of bathrooms and they were saying, because I feel like we as the media didn't do a good job of facilitating these conversations and getting out that story. So it was mostly the people who were kind of protesting in this way who got to drive that narrative.
Yeah, that's a good point. But I didn't even consider it in this interview. The person was saying that, you know, I look outwardly like a man. If I walk in the women's restroom, people are going to say, whoa, what's going on here? You know, but that, yeah, they're trying to, they say, protect against that kind of thing. So it's just, yeah, it's very different.
Well, this was good. I like the stop writing the same story all the time. That's pretty generalizable to a lot of different stories about community.
Sure.
Gotta grab this.
And that does bring up a good question. Do you think it's changing in the media? I mean, I certainly hear a lot more discussions of various, and then a lot of times it is the legal stuff. It's the HB2 things. But have you found the coverage to be getting generally better when it's a topic that focuses on transgender issues?
I would say it's a little bit of column A, column B. I wish I could think of an example off the top of my head now of, you know, a source that does really well at this.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, I can't. But I think that some news sources and some journalists get it right.
Mm-hmm.
This definitely isn't like everyone gets it wrong. No. But I also definitely think, I think there are people who get it right, and I think everyone else has the capacity to learn and, you know, get better. And I think it will get better as we move on.
Do you know of any communication departments that are doing research on the media's coverage of the issues? I mean, I just, maybe good Galileo search there.
Yeah. I'll have to go home and do that tonight.
Yeah.
Because off the top of my head, I don't.
Right. Yeah. I'm just sitting, racking my brain, thinking if I have any other questions.
Right, I'm trying to, yeah,
gives
make
me
sure.
A lot of stuff to, you say LAD has a style guide?
Mm-hmm. Right, they call it a media guide.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's you just Google GLAD media guide. 66 pages. It's not only transgender stuff, it's the entire LGBTQ spectrum.
Okay.
And it's terms to use, terms to avoid, different topics, and like how to approach those topics and what to avoid when approaching those topics.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, yeah, I've got a couple pages printed out here, but the entire thing is great. Unfortunately, I don't think it's been updated since like 2013, 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really looking forward to when they do update it.
I'll pull it down. Sounds good.
I just think, you know, as reporters, as writers, you know, it's just, and we all know this, everyone is a human and deserves to be heard and listen to their story and, you know, try not to go in with a preconceived notion, and because that's what our job is to share stories and the report them accurately, and give a voice to people who may not have one.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think that's when I interview transgender people, one of the, they're tired of not being considered human, is what I've heard. A lot of people that I used to interview, and I think that that just, I mean, and gay people in the beginning weren't considered human, you know, either, and it's just trying to have some kind of empathy, you know.
Another interesting story that only gets covered, in LGBT media is every year now since the Trans Pride March has went out, and so at Atlanta Pride we have a transgender Pride March, and it happens on Saturday before the main march on Sunday, and that started going out into the street in, it was either 2013 or 2014, and every year since we've done that, we've had issues where protesters almost block our entrance back into the park, and they'll follow us in and they'll have their bullhorns, and you know, it's basically just us, you know, trans pride marchers and them, the religious protesters, and we're kind of left to fend for ourselves, and it's kind of this tiny microcosm of what's happening at Atlanta Pride every year to this specific community, and only LGBT media ever covers it.
Well, let me get this straight. This is what, kind of a part of the Pride March? Is that what you're saying?
It's not. It's not part of the Sunday March. Not part of the parade.
It's a Sunday.
Right.
But the trans march in particular is targeted.
Right.
Oh.
Because I also march in what is still called the Dyke March,
mm-hmm.
And it is not targeted the same way. And of course, there are protesters at the parade on Sunday, but they're roped off. There's always, you know, police or security there, and it's a completely different type of environment.
Yeah, that just sounds, I mean, I went to some of the early Pride marches and don't really remember much other than maybe a few people standing on Peachtree with signs, any, you know, kind of targeted protest, and that was early. That was like some of the first ones here. So that's significant. That's interesting. Why do you think that is true? I mean, why the trans march rather than?
Well, I mean, I think it's, well, I mean, it was the Pope, I think it's still the most recent sitting Pope, who said that transgender people are as dangerous to God's plan as nuclear weapons. And most of these protests, or I would say all of these protesters are religious. They're in the style of the Westboro Baptist Church,
yeah.
Very inflammatory. And I think it is.
Are folks like that?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Right. And yeah, he's the liberal progressive.
I know, that's what, yeah,
likes.
Exactly, yeah.
But no, and so I think that, I think it's because, you know, transgender people are seen really as this kind of violent threat. To these, I guess, to these religious folks, which is unfortunate.
Yeah, I guess the thing that surprised me is they're also generally, those groups are generally homophobic also, you know, just in a more general sense, and so just targeting transgendered people,
right.
Rather than, anyway, it just kind of surprised me.
Well, if this might be a little too crass to say, and I can't pretend to know the methods of these protesters or what they hope to accomplish. But you know, if you think about when you're going to something like Pride and you have a certain expectation for what that environment's going to be like, and it's going to be happy and it's going to be optimistic, everyone's saying Happy Pride. But then you go to this trans march and you have this experience. You know, if you look at, again, the number of trans people who commit suicide, You know, whether that's their intention or not, how does it affect the mental health of transgender people having to deal with this and not having the solidarity of, you know, the rest of the Pride Parade or the rest of the community? Because we exit on 10th Street right by the Coke stage and come back into the park on 14th Street all the way across the park from the rest of, you know, the festivities.
Mm-hmm.
So we are very isolated.
Okay, that's...
I went to the very first trans march when it used to still be through the park, and you could hear participants, attendees who are gay or and dismissive of trans people as well. That's one of the issues that we're dealing with also.
Right.
So, but I will say that march has gotten huge
right.
compared to how it was.
Right.
And I was only a couple years ago when young people started marching with their parents too in the march, which was amazed me at watching the progress. So yeah, I mean, I would get depressed walking into Pride and having to listen to stupid protesters just standing at the gate. You know, I can't, and I have seen the trans march be targeted, and it's really, really horrible.
Mm.
But, anyway.
Okay.
All right,
good
job.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much. Thank you for coming and choosing this panel and being really great.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're welcome. Love that. Love a good list incorporated into my own little personal style guide.
Yeah, I like a lot. Sure.
I'm
going to
Tisdale, and the video will be
there. Thank you. How are you doing? I read about you. You're not in jail, are you?
Evidently
not.
Today,
but I'm out on $6,000 bond.
Wow.
$6,000 bond.
I watched the Pumpkin Gate YouTube videos.
There were some recent developments in that, right?
Yeah, there was
a hearing last month.
Okay, yeah. I heard of that. I'd like a card. Do you have a few more?
Of course, yes.
Does your Does your PayPal help keep you out of jail? Any? Well, I'm saying, because I'll donate to it.
Oh, that would be lovely.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I will shoot you an email. Yeah, I'm in between jobs.
Great to see you again.
Good seeing you too.
I'll see you around.
Yeah, I'll remember you and probably won't try to interview you next time.